Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our service of worship this morning. We're so glad that you are here. This is Thanksgiving week. They're giving me the sign down here. There you go. All right, it's Thanksgiving week, and so excited about that. Many are going to be seeing family and friends, either traveling to them or having them come visit you, and that's wonderful. Very excited about that. I want to give you some announcements so you know what's going on in the life of the church, and while I do that, if you would, give us a registration of your attendance. There's red pew pads on the end of each row. Pass those down. We certainly would appreciate that this morning. I'm not going to go into great detail on announcements because I know that preacher is long-winded today. So that would be me I'm talking about. So I'm going to go through these quickly this morning. Board of Stewards is meeting right after church today. Shouldn't be a very long meeting. We just want to make sure we cover some things and everybody's up to speed on some things. Y'all saw the new striping in the parking lot out here this morning, I thought. That's a great job. Show our appreciation, trustees, getting that together for us. And so it looks really, really good. There's a special luncheon coming up on December the 5th at 11 o'clock after our service. It's going to be in celebration and honor of Pastor Tammy, who's going to be retiring here at the end of the year. And so it's a soup and sandwich lunch, and there's a sign-up sheet. I know it went around the Sunday school classes. I think it's in Harper Hall as well, if you'd like to help participate, plus to let us know if you're going to be there for that. But that'll be on December the 5th. Potluck Summer coming up December 8th, so be aware of that. Poinsettias, we've had a hard time the last couple of years finding a place to buy the poinsettias. We've been getting them through Brookshire's the last couple of years. Sometimes that's good, sometimes that's not so good. They're not really set up to do wholesale kind of stuff like that. And recently we have found a distributor, and so we're going to have our poinsettias again. And if you'd like to purchase them in memory or in honor of someone, you'll find the sign-up sheets out in Harper Hall for that. Children's Ministry today at 4 p.m. We're going to be going, they're meeting at Walmart on South Broadway, correct? Okay. They're going to be picking up toys and gifts and goodies for the Holiday of Hope benefit for the Children's Advocacy Center. Hanging of the Greens, for those of you who are new to church and never heard that phrase before, no, we're not hanging the Green family. We are, hanging of the Greens is an old phrase of saying decorating the church. Some churches actually have a whole service around it and everything, but we just get together and we're going to do that on November 27th. Everybody who can join us will put up the Christmas tree, have the altar decorated and the wreaths around and do a little decoration in different places in the church. If you can help us on that 2 o'clock time on Saturday, November 27th, we sure would appreciate it. Alternative Christmas, we've done this before, where you can make a donation to one of three charities, and a card will be given to the person that you do that in honor of. So it's another way of doing a Christmas gift and doing it in such a way that you're saying to the person, I've given a gift to this organization in your name for their benefit and blessing. So it's an alternative way to do Christmas. There's other things going on in the announcements. I'm going to let you read those, but I am going to ask Diane. She's going to come forward from the Finance Committee to give us an announcement.
Good morning. This is the time of the year whenever we give donations to provide a bonus, a year-end bonus for our staff, to show them how grateful we are for their service to us. If you would like to donate to that cause, please mark your check staff bonus or put your cash in an envelope marked staff bonus. Or if you use online, there is a drop down on the online giving that will say staff bonus, and you can designate your offering to that cause. This is done strictly by donation. We do not take this out of our operating fund, and so we appreciate all of the participation. We will have this open until December the 5th. Thank you.
All right. If there are not any other announcements, then I invite you to stand and greet one another in the name of the Lord. Thank you.
dwell in me. Spirit of power within, and bring the glorious liberty from sorrow, fear, and sin. I ask no higher state, indulge me but in this, and soon or later then translate to thine eternal bliss. Please remain standing.
Welcome. Please join me in our call to worship. Enter God's gates with thanksgiving and God's courts with praise. Give thanks and bless God's holy name. You may be seated as we prepare our hearts to worship God.
Stand with me, please, as we sing Cornerstone. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, in the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
You may be seated for children's time.
Morning. Thank y'all for coming. So I have a puzzle here, but before I show you the whole puzzle, I'm just going to show you one piece. What do you think it is? Any idea? Okay, let's see. I'm going to take this little piece and put it right here. Now what is it?
A hammer.
It's a hammer and some tools, yeah. But when you just see this one little piece, we don't really know how that fits in the puzzle, do we? How that fits in the whole plan. So today, we're finishing up our story about Joseph, right? So we've been talking about him for several weeks. And if you remember Joseph, he had some quite interesting adventures. Some of them were not so fun, right? So his dad gave him a really beautiful something. What was it?
Cloak.
coat. That's right. His dad gave him a beautiful coat, so that was a fun part of his story. And then his brothers, how did they feel about that coat?
Mad.
They were mad and they were jealous. So what did they do to him? They put him in a pit, and then they sold him to be a slave. So we heard about all these different parts of Joseph's story. So do you think it was very fun to be thrown down in a pit? No, no. If that was the end of Joseph's story, how would that story be? Not very good, right? Yeah. So that was just part of Joseph's story, right? And then being a slave, that was just part of his story. It's kind of like a piece in the puzzle. Being in the pit was a piece of the puzzle. Being a slave was a piece of his puzzle. But Jesus and God knew that they had a bigger picture for Joseph. They had an idea. They knew something important was coming, that with all of these pieces, all of these things that happened to him were getting him ready for something very important. And we're going to hear about that today. Pastor David's going to talk about that today. And that end of the story is where Joseph gets to be promoted to a very important man in Egypt, and he helped protect the people of Israel and all of the people in that region from famine. He helped save them through God's wisdom by preparing grain and storing food. And so through Joseph, God saved a lot of people from starvation and from hunger. So even though Joseph went through some hard times in his life, God knew that he had a special plan and a special purpose for all of those things to happen to him. We're all going to come together for a really important purpose. So the story of Joseph is good for us, because when we are having a bad day or a hard time, whether it's we're really struggling at school, maybe we have a really hard math test coming up, or maybe one of our friends is not being kind to us and it hurts our feelings, do you know that God has a big plan and a big picture for our lives? And even though bad things do not come from God, he can work through bad things to help build our character and build our faith so that we can do great and amazing things for him, just like Joseph. So when you're having a bad day, just remember, it's just a piece of your puzzle. We don't really know what God has planned for you when you're in the middle of a hard time, but we know that he is with us and that he will use even bad things to do good things. Remember that? Okay, let's pray. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for being with us on the bad days and the good days. Please help us to lean on you on our bad days and trust you have a plan for us, just like Joseph. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay.
Let us stand as we affirm our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all it is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated.
Would you pray with me? Almighty, eternal, and holy God, who is, who was, and who is to come, worthy are you to receive our praise and thanksgiving. Here in this holy place where you have promised to dwell among us, we gather to offer our praise to your holy name. To you be glory and dominion forever. Your revelation in Jesus Christ gives life to our bodies and souls. He has shown us the way to everlasting life and has promised to make us priests and a royal nation, but not in a place that we can see in the here and now. Still, we try to fit your ways into our expectations, and then we grumble when you do not conform. Where we have doubted your wisdom and your truth, forgive us, good and gracious Lord. Jesus was born to come into the world and bear witness to the truth. He has said that whoever is of the Spirit hears his voice. By the outpouring of your Holy Spirit, equip us to bear witness to that same truth and so help others in hearing your voice. On this day, we await your coming in power to reclaim your church and establish the reign of righteousness. In that same power, we ask you to take into your care those whom we name this day in our hearts. Relieve their suffering and their captivity and restore their brokenness. O God, our Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, hear our prayers, and in your mercy, answer them in Jesus' name. It is Jesus who taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Will you stand with me, please, as we sing For the Beauty of the Earth?
Our hymn of
Most gracious Heavenly Father, as we approach the Thanksgiving season and the Advent season, we have so many things to be thankful for. Thankful that you sent your Son into this world. Thankful that you would make the ultimate sacrifice on our behalf so that we would have eternal life. Lord, we are thankful for the many blessings you've given us. We're thankful for the challenges you give us that temper us and bring us closer to you. Lord, we pray that as we return some of our financial gifts to you, you would bless them to service according to your will throughout your world. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated.
Trumpet sound. knees are bending. Poor sinner stands a trembling. The trumpet sounds within my soul. I ain't got long to stay here. Steal away, steal away, steal.
Let us stand for our scripture reading. Our scripture today comes from Genesis chapter 42, verses 1 through 11. When Jacob learned that there was grain in Egypt, he said to his sons, "Why do you just keep looking at each other?" He continued, "I have heard that there is grain in Egypt. Go down there and buy some for us so that we may live and not die." Then 10 of Joseph's brothers went down to buy grain from Egypt. But Jacob did not send Benjamin, Joseph's brother, with the others because he was afraid that harm might come to him. So Israel's sons were among those who went to buy grain, for there was famine in the land of Canaan also. Now Joseph was the governor of the land, the person who sold grain to all its people. So when Joseph's brothers arrived, they bowed down to him with their faces to the ground. As soon as Joseph saw his brothers, he recognized them, but he pretended to be a stranger and spoke harshly to them. "Where do you come from?" he asked. "From the land of Canaan," they replied, "to buy food." Although Joseph recognized his brothers, they did not recognize him. Then he remembered his dreams about them and said to them, "You are spies. You have come to see where our land is unprotected." "No, my lord," they answered, "your servants have come to buy food. We are all the sons of one man. Your servants are honest men, not spies." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight this day, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen? Amen. Amen. So every summer when we were kids growing up, we would make a trek to Tennessee, Jackson, Tennessee, Selmer, Tennessee, to go see the grandparents. Mom's side is from Selmer, dad's side is from Jackson. But every summer, we'd make this trek to go visit the Tennessee relatives. And we would start off this trek every year with Mom, whether we were in the station wagon when we were little or in the Ford van Dad had, drove until that thing fell apart. We would hear Mom say these words, "Buckle up for safety." Now, Mom, if you're watching online, which she occasionally does, that's what you said every single time. Buckle up for safety. Well, we're about to finish up a cross-country trek with Joseph and his story, and we still got a little ways to go. We're not there yet, but we're making progress, and we're going to end up today finishing up his story. And so we have a lot to cover, and so with that in mind, I'm inviting you to buckle up for safety, because here we go. Famine has spread across the land, just as God had revealed to Pharaoh in his dreams, which Joseph had interpreted for him. Joseph's father, Jacob, tells his boys, "Quit staring at each other and your navels and get to Egypt. We are starving and we need some grain." That famine that was predicted did not only affect Egypt, it affected all the areas of all the land around it, including Canaan. And so the brothers, 10 of them at least, pack up mules and donkeys or whatever, and they make their way to go down to Egypt. Now, they all go except Benjamin. And Benjamin, of course, is the youngest living brother to their knowledge. They don't realize that Joseph's still alive yet. And Jacob is still very, the father is still very sensitive about the loss of Joseph. And so he does not want to see happen again what happened to Joseph. So he is very cautious, very protective of young Benjamin. And so those 10 brothers go to Egypt, and when they get there, they are brought into the room where the governor is, and the governor is Joseph. He has been put in charge of all of Egypt. He's second only under Pharaoh, and so immediately Joseph recognizes his brothers. And, you know, you got to think about this. When they come into the room and they see all these Egyptians, they don't recognize Joseph. Well, the reason for that likely is the fact that Joseph has, at that time, adopted Egyptian dress, adopted Egyptian attire, even men wore facial makeup and things like that around their eyes and things like that. So they did not recognize him. But they come into the room where he is, and he certainly recognizes them. And so upon doing so, Joseph doesn't treat them well. He kind of puts them through the ringer, if you will, and he accuses them of being spies, to which, of course, they deny. Oh, no, 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 we're not spies. And to try to paint a picture of them as a good family and from, you know, good stock, good people, they began to tell them about, oh, we're all brothers of the same father, and our youngest brother's at home with him, and don't worry, we're good people. Joseph responds by saying, well, if you're such good people, then let's prove what you've just told me. You told me you had a younger brother. You told me he was at home. If it's true and you're good people and that's true, then you can bring him to me. And they kind of stem and stammered a little bit and wondered about that, what it would mean to bring their younger brother back as proof they were telling the truth. Now, eventually it's worked out that they will go back and get him, hoping to convince their father to allow him to come back. But in the meantime, one of the brothers, Simeon, has to stay in prison, basically, while the rest of the brothers are going back to get Benjamin. So that's the plan. Return to Canaan, convince Jacob, they allow them to bring Benjamin back to Egypt, and then the Pharaoh will see their youngest, Simeon will be released, they'll get their grain and go on home. Well, this all may seem like an odd thing for Joseph to do, but in fact, his putting this pressure upon them reaches the desired effect that he is looking for out of his brothers. Because while they're in the room discussing this plan, what to do with Simeon, Simeon's going to be in prison, we're going to go with this, we're going to do that, we're going to get Benjamin, Joseph is hearing all this. And Joseph hears what's going on. And he also hears that they are caught in the middle of an internal strife amongst themselves, an internal realization amongst themselves. They are tying this conflict or this struggle back to their own past behaviors. And Joseph hears this when they say to one another in Genesis chapter 42, 21, he says, surely we are being punished. This is the brothers talking. Surely we are being punished because of our brother. We saw how distressed he was when he pleaded with us for his life, but we did not listen. That's why this distress has come on us. Reuben said, didn't I tell you not to sin against that boy? But you wouldn't listen. Now we must give an accounting for his blood. Remember, this is all taking place in front of Joseph. And yet Joseph doesn't relent. He doesn't give up. He continues on with this method to his madness. And then he goes to do something even stranger. It says in Genesis chapter 42, verse 25 and 26, that Joseph gave orders to fill their bags with grain. So they go ahead and get the grain, which is good. They've paid for the grain with silver, but each man's silver is put back into their individual sacks of grain. And they are given provisions for them on their journey. And after this was all done, they loaded up their grain and their donkeys, and they left. Now, the brothers are heading home. It's not a quick trip. It takes quite a long time to get from Egypt to Canaan. And at one of the stops overnight, one of the brothers opens up his pack to discover that his silver has been returned in the top of his sack of grain. My silver has been returned, he said to his brothers. Here it is in my sack. And their heart sank as they turned to each other, trembling, and said, "What is this that God has done to us?" You see, God is at work in this situation. He's bringing them to a place. It's a place that we're going to see them transformed, but it takes a little time first. So finally, here they reach home to tell their father about Jacob and about their experience. And as they're getting down and they're taking down their sacks of grain, they all open their sacks of grain to discover, gosh, all of their silver has been returned. And if that wasn't scary enough, now they know they're going to have to go into their father and try in some way, shape, or form to convince the man, "You've got to release Benjamin to us in order for Simeon to be brought home and so that we can be a family again." As frightening as that was, Jacob emphatically says, "No, you are not taking my youngest son. You cannot do to me what happened to Joseph. If something like that happens again," he's basically telling them, "this will kill me. You can't do this. Don't take Benjamin." And so they don't. And they leave Simeon in prison in Egypt and probably just bide their time until they try, hopefully can convince Jacob maybe down the road somewhere to let them take Benjamin. Well, things do turn. The tides do turn, if you will. The grain that they had purchased runs out. They have no idea how long this famine is going to be. It's less than halfway through at this point. And they are once again out of grain and in desperate sorts. And so Jacob finally relents and says, "Okay, you can take Benjamin back with you." Judah, the oldest brother, pledges a promise with his father, promising that he will bring him back safely. And so they load up their mules with the silver that they originally gave so that they can take it back to Egypt, and also another additional silver for each of them so that they can buy more grain. And then they put together the first gift basket ever noted in Scripture. They get together a little bit of fruit from here and the best of the olive oil from here and the best of the dates from here. All of the stuff that was known about their land, they put it together in the first gift basket ever written of in Scripture. And they take this to Egypt to give to Joseph. Now, when they get to Egypt, Joseph receives them and tells them, "Go to my house. Somebody take them to my house. We're going to have a feast together." And so they're sitting there worried because, first off, they didn't expect to be taken to some feast. I mean, is this the feast where they're going to chop their heads off? Or what about the silver and the sack incidents? Were they going to reprimand us here and there? Or what's the deal? And so they pull aside one of the stewards that's over Joseph's household and maybe getting everything together for the meal and all that kind of stuff. And they want to kind of prepare him so maybe he'll say something to Joseph that is nice so that Joseph won't do anything mean to them. Now remember, they don't know this is Joseph. All they know is he's a governor of Egypt. And so they say to Joseph's steward, "Listen, we brought back the silver. I don't know how, but it got in the sacks." And this is what Joseph's steward says to them. He says, "It's all right. Don't be afraid. Your God, the God of your father, has given you treasure in your sacks. I received your silver." And then he brought Simeon out to meet them. When Joseph arrives at the house, he's unconcerned about the silver issue. He's unconcerned about the gift baskets. He's unconcerned about what's in it. He is more concerned about his father. And so he asks them about the father, and they reply, "Your servant, our father, is still alive and well." They bowed down and prostrated themselves before him. Now, did you catch that? They bowed down and prostrated themselves. You know what the word prostrate means? It's not prostate. Come on now. It's prostrate. It's when you basically lay yourself out flat on your stomach on the ground, completely on the ground. They prostrated themselves. Now, where have we seen that image and picture before? It's the same image and picture that Joseph dreamed about as a 17-year-old boy that got him in trouble with his brothers in the first place. Here is the fulfillment. Actually, this is one of three times in the story that we read this happening. This is the fulfillment of the dream that God had given Joseph. Not once, but twice. So, they have a feast. They prepare them to go. And then they prepare them for their departure. Now, Joseph has his stewards put their grain together. and has them not only put their silver back in their sack once again, he also has them take his own personal silver cup and places it in Benjamin's sack of all the sacks. Now, this is a method to his madness. There's an end outcome that we're looking for, and we see God using this in their lives to bring about a particular transformation. They go off from the feast. They think everything's good. They've got their sacks of grain. They make it barely steps out of the gate, and here comes the steward back and says, I need to see inside of your sack. And so he opens up all of the sacks, and there he finds the silver, but he seems less concerned about the silver until he gets to Benjamin's sack and say, aha, I have found Joseph's personal cup. The brothers at that point are devastated. They tear their clothes in a sign of devastation, in a sign of grief, in a sign of knowing what this means. That Benjamin is going to be taken in, and certainly he was. They all go back to Joseph's house. Benjamin is then found guilty, of which he would then be told that he is going to become a slave in Egypt, a fate they know will kill their father upon hearing it, break his heart to death. You see, Benjamin's safe return, as I mentioned, was promised by Judah that he would take care of him. He promised his father on his life that he would not let anything happen to Benjamin, and here it is. The thing that he did not want to happen, happened. And the brothers are distraught, and Judah begins to plead with Joseph right before him. And then it says, then Judah went up to him and said, pardon your servant, my lord. Let me speak a word, my lord. Do not be angry with your servant, though you are equal to Pharaoh himself. My lord asked his servants, do you have a father or brother? And he answered, we have an aged father, and there is a young son born to him in his old age. His brother is dead. They're referring to Joseph there. They think he's dead. And he is the only one of his father's sons left, and his father loves him. Joseph then tells him to go and get this father they are speaking of, but Judah knows this won't work. As soon as he steps his foot over the threshold of that door and Benjamin is not with him, he knows that his father will die of a broken heart. It's as if his sins are coming due. And here it is, we see the full transformation that has taken place in Judah's heart. It's here at this moment that we realize all of this was for a reason. All of this was for a purpose. Not just the silver and the sacks, but the pit and prison and Egypt and slavery. All of it was for a purpose of something greater. We see this first in Judah's transformed heart. Before Judah and the other brothers as well were only bothered by young brothers. They wanted nothing to do with young Joseph when he was around the household. He was a bother to him. He was a tattletale for them. They didn't like him being around. They had no care for his care. They had no concern for his life. They treated little brothers as nothing. And yet here they are concerned about their youngest brother. Little brothers were of no value, but now little brothers are of great value. Before, Judah and the other brothers didn't think about their father's need. They had no concern about what selling Joseph off would mean for their father because they were so selfish and self-centered. But here they have great concern for their father. Their lives have changed. Their demeanor has changed. Their heart has changed. And now they are at a place where they have been transformed through this experience. And now they care for more than just themselves. They care about their brother. They care about their father. And they care about causing this grief and this past sin they committed against Joseph himself, never wanting to repeat that pain for either their brother, Benjamin, or their father. We see Judah's transformation most clearly in what he says next, or what he does next in Genesis 44. Now then, please let your servant remain here. He's saying this to Joseph. Let your servant remain here as my Lord's slave in place of the boy. He wants to take the place of the one who has sinned, who has allegedly stolen. Let me take the place of the boy, and let the boy return with his brothers. How can I go back to my father if the boy is not with me? No, do not let me see the misery that would come on my father. How like Jesus are his actions, willing to take the place of another and suffer their punishment. It's after this amazing transformation of Judah's heart and the heart of his brothers that Joseph decides to reveal himself to his brothers. But before he does, he sends all out of the room all of the Egyptians. He don't want, this is family business now. This isn't for anybody else. Sends the Egyptians all away, and he begins to weep loudly. And Joseph says to his brothers, I am Joseph. Is my father still living? But his brothers were not able to answer him because they were terrified at his presence. I mean, think about this for a minute. This is the brother that you once hated. This is the brother that you once treated poorly. This is the brother that you once planned to kill. This is the brother that you threw into a pit. This is the brother that you sold off into slavery. This is the brother now standing before you. He is in the room and has all of the power. He is the one that holds your lives in his hand. And he could easily enact his revenge right here and right now. And he would, by worldly standards, be justified in doing so. But instead of revenge, which they deserve, instead they receive mercy and grace. Then Joseph said to his brothers, come close to me. You're not far off anymore. We're together. I receive you. This is almost like the prodigal father embracing the prodigal son. But in this case, it's the prodigal sons. He says, come close to me. When they had done so, he said, I am your brother Joseph, the one you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed and do not be angry with yourselves for selling me here. Because it was to save lives that God sent me ahead of you. Listen to that. It was to save lives that God has sent me ahead of you. For 2 years now there has been a famine in the land, and for the next 5 years there will be no plowing and reaping. In other words, the famine is going to go on. But God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. Joseph, in essence, is saying to them, God has had a greater plan all along. You may not have seen it. I certainly didn't understand it. But God had painted a larger picture. And it is ours to see now. And that none of us may have been aware of it in the beginning. God has been at work all along the way. In short, God has taken something bad and used it for good. These are words that Joseph would echo years later to his brother. You see, after this event, they do go and get their father and bring everything else up back to Egypt with them, basically transport their entire household and goods and farms and cattle and all that stuff and sheep or whatever they had, and they transfer everybody up. They're given the land of Goshen, which is some of the most fertile land in Egypt. Not right now because we have a famine, but it would be one of the most fertile lands in Egypt. And here they have this place with them, and all things are good and well. But then the father dies, Jacob dies. And the brothers once again become concerned because now the father is not there to make sure that Joseph still continues to treat them well. And it's a difficult thing. But listen to what Joseph says to his brothers once again. Showing grace and showing mercy. In Genesis chapter 50, we read these words. But Joseph said to them, do not be afraid. They were afraid he's going to kill them, you know. Oh, our father's dead now. He's going to enact his revenge. No. He says, do not be afraid. Am I in the place of God? You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. That, my friends, is grace. That, my friends, is grace. Grace is unmerited favor, undeserved kindness, unearned love. I want to give you two takeaways this morning. Two takeaways, real brief, about the story of Joseph and what it means for us. And the first takeaway is this. Joseph gives us an example of God's love toward us. Folks, we are the brothers in the story. We are the ones who have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. All the brothers of Joseph had sinned. They were all deserving of death. Joseph had the power to see this happen. But instead of death, Joseph offers them life. Joseph forgives his brothers. Joseph restores them to life, and not just everyday ho-hum life, but abundant life in the land of Goshen. And he blesses them. Joseph's actions remind us of God's actions towards us, as written in the Psalms, Psalm 103, how the Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. God is a God of grace. God is a God of grace. God gives us his love and his forgiveness, his unmerited favor, his undeserved kindness. And he extends that to everyone who would but receive that. That's the first takeaway. The second takeaway is this: God is in the business of making something good out of something that is bad. Let me say it again. God is in the business of making something good out of that which is bad. This story happens over and over again in life. It's happened in your life. It's happened in others' lives. But this story of how God can take our difficult times, how God can take the pits of our lives and deliver us from them. And how God can take the struggles of our lives. You know, it wasn't just the pit, it was this being sold into slavery. It wasn't just the pit, it was the being accused of adultery. It wasn't just the pit, it was being sold into or taken into prison. Through it all, God was with Joseph. And God was still at work. He didn't say, oh, Joseph's in a pit. I don't think I want to stick around for that. He didn't say, oh, Joseph's in a tight spot with Potiphar. I don't want anything to do with that. He didn't say, oh, Joseph's in prison. I think he probably got himself there on his own. I don't want anything to do with that. No, God was with Joseph every single step of the way. And Joseph very easily could have gotten caught up in that pit. He could have gotten caught up in looking at the roots, the rocks, the rubble, the dust, the dirt, and could have said, this is life, and this is all there is, and I'm just going to sit here and be miserable. But instead, Joseph looked up. He looked up to God, and God carried him through that. He got him out of that pit. He got him through that debacle with Potiphar's wife. He got them through prison. And even in the midst of that, God was using him. Do you remember? God was using him to be a blessing to all these other people. And God wanted to continue to use him to be a blessing in other people's lives. And so it's through this, what we see is that God has this habit. God has this business of redeeming our stuff. You know what I mean? God has a habit of redeeming our past, which we may want to forget. God has a way of turning that past into a witness. He has a way of turning that problem into a testimony. He has a way of having that difficult time in our lives be the thing that we are able to share with someone else who needs the word of encouragement, word, so that we can look at them and say, you know what? I've been down a similar road. And guess what? I can now look back and say, God has remained faithful to me even in that dark hour of my life. And I know right now you want to look at the rocks, and you want to look at the roots, and you want to look at the dirt, and you want to look at the dust, but I want to challenge you to look up. And I want to encourage you to look up to the Lord who carries you through those difficult times, who climbs down in the pit so that he can bring you out of it. Trust in the Lord. Are you allowing your story to be a witness to others? Are you allowing your pit to be a proclamation of God's deliverance? Are you allowing your problems to be the thing that you can witness to someone else about to say, you know what? Yeah, I went through a rough time. Yeah, it was not fun in any way, shape, or form. But God saw me through that. That word may be just the thing someone in your life this week or this month or the end of this year, maybe next year, needs to hear. They need to hear your story. They need to hear your story so they can claim God's truth of redemption and deliverance, of healing or hope or wholeness. And so trust in the Lord and speak God's truth about His love and His grace, His provision, His protection, His care, whatever it is. Speak that so that others may come to know the same truth of God's grace in their lives. Amen? Amen. Our closing song this morning is My Hope Is Built. If you're here this morning and God has moved in your heart and life to publicly profess your faith in Jesus Christ, or if you've already done so and you're now ready to make a faith commitment by becoming a member of Boulder First United Methodist Church, we'd love to talk to you about that and what that means, share with you a vision for ministry, but also what it means to become a Christian, how you can do either one of those things, and share with you in prayer about both those things. Come talk to either myself or Pastor Tammy after the service, or give us a call. This week we'll be, I'll be out of pocket this week. I think, will you be in the first of the week at all? Okay, so Tammy will be in town the first of the week. Of course, Thanksgiving is coming up. If there is an emergency, please don't hesitate to call one of us, and we'll make sure somebody gets to you and gets things taken care of. So let us stand together as we sing, My Hope Is Built.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
This morning we had Olivia and Emerson doing the acolyting for us. I don't know if, I hope you got a chance to see the Facebook post this week. Emerson was baptized. We did it by immersion out in the courtyard this past Wednesday. It was a beautiful celebration and good with family, and had church folks there as well. So we celebrate that. I think we ought to give God the glory for that. And so thank you. A young child committing their life to Jesus Christ. What a great, great thing. So would you receive now this benediction? Go forth in the power and strength that God gives you to be the children of God, to lead lives of faithfulness and trust, even when things get tough, so that on the end we can look back and see where God has been with us all along the way. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Amen. Amen.